So, okay, we are over 100 participants, so this is the magic number. This is now good to start. We don't have to lose much time. I remember all of you, first of all, welcome on board of this third episodes of the Easy Talks that will be dedicated to vitamin D and COVID. Yeah, I remember to all of you that there is a question and answer button. The ones that already follow the other webinars know that they can write their questions, and I will ask those questions to the panel at the end of the talk. Obviously, if there is a question that other people already asked, please, if you have the same question, to press the thumbs up button, and I will know that there are many people that would like to have an answer to that question. So after the live session, this will be recorded and put on our EC website for at least 1 week after the seminar. So please, if you will be so astonished by the webinar, you can go and see again it in 1 week, not too many times because this may be negative for your health. So thank you very much for joining today. You are a lot of people, you are a lot of members, you come from many countries. We counted that 370 countries are represented today in this webinar. So welcome all, and pleasure to meet you. This is a very special webinar because I have the pleasure to host in this webinar Anna Maria Formenti, who is one of my fellows in San Raffaele in Milano, and she will be the leader, and she will give the webinar on vitamin D and COVID. But also, I have the enormous pleasure to host two fantastic panelists. One is known to many of you because he's Camilla Scianti, who is a monument of the European Society of Endocrinology. She has been chair of the Education Committee of the Society for many years, and it is an enormous pleasure to have her with us today. And the other is also well known in Europe. Sometimes I joke and he can ask the European citizenship for how many times he is invited to Europe to speak. And he's a monument of calcium metabolism in the world, John Vilezikian from New York. And this is a true pleasure, guys, to have you here and to be able to offer your vision and opinion to our members and to all the people that are connected to the webinar today. Thank you very much. So I always start saying that I will not lose much time, and then at the end I lose time, but this because I have to say important things, and not less important, I would say even more important, is what Anna Maria Formenti is now ready to tell us about vitamin D in COVID-19. Anna, thank you very much, please.
Okay, thank you Andrea, thank you European Society to this great opportunity to be here today with you. I'm very excited to treat this topic. Today's topic is vitamin D in the COVID era.
So you need
This
to
is
start from the first
the
slide.
agenda. This one, can you see it?
No, this now yes.
Okay, perfect. Sorry. Today this is the agenda of my talk, and for the very few of you who do not remember what is vitamin D, just in brief, vitamin D is an absolutely important hormone that let us absorb calcium, and not only. The major natural source of vitamin D derives from skin epidermis, and also by food we can introduce vitamin D. It is known from many years that vitamin D is key for skeletal health. But in the very last year has been emergent also other important possible rules for this kind of hormone. And one of the reasons is the fact that the vitamin D receptor is almost expressed everywhere in the body, and particularly in, also in lung and in immune system. So why we started thinking of vitamin D? When the COVID-19 storm started. These are the multiple mechanisms that links vitamin D to predisposition to viral and respiratory infection. In fact, vitamin D in immunity and the regulation of in a quite recently an important meta-analysis reported an action infection for vitamin D, and particularly when vitamin D was less than 10 nanogram for milliliter, there was a 17% lower risk of infection. We start also to consider the possible link between vitamin D and COVID. The classical Scandinavians without food fortification compared to North countries such as, for example, Norvegia, that fortified diagnosis D in Europe does overlap with the diffusion and also the mortality of COVID-19 as reported in this study. In particular, the Italian numbers COVID-19 are truly impressive. As you can see, the number of infected and rate and mortality rate is striking high and related to specific conditions and comorbidities such as, for example, age, diabetes and obesity. Our thinking of the central rule of vitamin D in COVID-19 has been strengthened by the operation. In fact, elderly people do have decreased, and in Italy, recent statistics show that more than 11% of total Italian population is over 75 years old. COVID-19 elderly patients die for COVID. For this kind of infection were predominantly males, and males are much more likely to be on treatment with vitamin D, as shown by this recent Italian observational study. In Italy, has been postmenopausal women with type 2 diabetes had more frequent postmenopausal women who control postmenopause. I reported to you the, also to a resistance to treatment with vitamin D, as we reported in a recent specific setting that of hypoparathyroid patients, and you can see here. Smoking is also associated with COVID-19 morbidity, also linked to sex difference in the spread of infection. But smoking has also negative effects on vitamin D metabolism. In fact, smoking reduces vitamin D activation. Ethnical difference in vitamin deficiency because they have dark. So at this point, since our thinking was corroborated by this epidemiological interference, we started thinking of possible direct mechanism through which vitamin D could specifically influence our immune system and that are also helpful to repair airway pathway epithelium. But also vitamin D is important in modulate the immune response, allowing to prevent cytokine storm in COVID-19's hearts. In particular, is possible to reduce interleukin 6 and interferon in order to reduce the gravity of the severity of this infection. Vitamin D is also important in reduce point of link for the virus. In fact, ACE2 is very important in COVID. So I thought that more specific information of interaction between vitamin D and ACE2 would be of help. You have to remember that vitamin D stimulates synthesis of ACE that is able to produce ACE2. ACE2 is of protection against the link of virus to our airway epithelium. Let's now consider also another hypothesis. We could have polymorphism in vitamin D receptor gene alleles that could be associated with increased or decreased susceptibility to respiratory infection and also to COVID. Let's now come to the real data world, which is unfortunately not much populated yet. In this Italian study, you can see the likelihood to be infected by COVID-19 is related to low level of vitamin D. And this is particularly true when you consider people aged over 70 years old. This is the report of this Italian study that enrolled about 100 patients. So we have also another study. This is from Southeast, and this is a study that correlates vitamin D with the severity of the infection. In fact, as you when you consider critical infection, the value of vitamin D is very more frequently very low. And this is what reported this study from Philippines. At this point, we have a good rationale to think a treatment with vitamin D in COVID-19. So, as we wrote already 2 months ago in our letter to British Medical Journal, we information about replace vitamin lockdown, also because it's not always so simple. Simple to take a sun bath during the day. So, what we have to do in people with in generally population, we have to maintain vitamin D treatment in those already diagnosed with hypovitaminosis D. The bedroll, it is before supplementation with vitamin D of elderly comorbid person at home confinement, and we also have to include, to consider universal supplementation with vitamin D due to high risk of complicated COVID-19 infection in Italy and other countries, also in hospitalized and very illness patients. We have to remember, in fact, that ECU patients are, as already reported for ECU patients, that in this kind of patient, there is frequently an incidence of hypovitaminosis D that appear to have some clinical benefit when corrected, for example, as reported in this randomized control trial. So these are now these are some of the multiple initiatives that have been started around in the world. This is one in China. These are two in Europe, the first in France, the second in UK. These are ongoing trials in order to evaluate the importance of supplementation of vitamin D in general population in order to prevent COVID-19 infection, and also in acute ill patients in order to reduce the severity of infection. We also are studying the level of vitamin D and calcium in our large population, Italian population of COVID-19 patients, but also in medical staff in order to retrospectively and prospectively evaluate the incidence and prognostic impact of low level both of calcium and vitamin D. So, in conclusion, what 2 months ago in our letter on British Medical Journal appeared to be something like more to us simply acquired the dignity of a scientific valuable topic. So thank you all for the kind attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Anna, for this very nice presentation. We had some technical problems here and there, so we lost your voice sometimes. But the slides were good, so we could follow well the talk and the webinar, although the voice was not continuous. So thank you very much. And I would like to take the advantage of having Camilla and John in the panel to ask them for a first round of comments and ideas around the topic. Camilla, please.
Yes, thank you, Anna, very much. I think this is a very important topic, as we know that the old people are most severely affected by COVID, and I think that this vitamin D story is largely overlooked so far, because as we know, it coincides hypovitaminosis D and COVID in the old ones. So I think this is a very important message to everyone listening. And I think we will learn a lot from your studies where you really will assess vitamin D status and outcome of COVID in Italy. So these are my first short comments. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you, Camilla. John, please, your first round of comments from your side.
Okay, thank you, Andrea. And thank you, Anna. You did a beautiful job describing really one of the more recent observations relating risk factors for COVID-19 infection. And I do believe that the story of vitamin D is going to become more elucidated in the weeks to come as more information becomes available. The irony of this discussion one could put into historical context. In the 1930s, well before any of us was alive, patients with tuberculosis were treated in sanatoriums. They were placed in the country. We did not have anti-tuberculous drugs. They were provided full sun and they recovered. And that was really one of the first observations that vitamin D, that is from the sun, could have antibacterial actions. And as Anna beautifully reviewed, there is information about general risk of infections in those who are vitamin D deficient. And with regard to COVID-19, she pointed out the other risk factors, diabetes, obesity, smoking, men, all may be people who have lower vitamin D levels than others in the population. And also on a review, some of the interesting immune-specific mechanisms that have been implicated in vitamin D action. There are lots and lots of questions, and I will not go further, but I wanted to just point out that the relationship between vitamin D and infections in general, and maybe COVID-19 in particular, we need to ascertain that as a causal relationship, and that has not been made yet. And if there is a causal relationship, to determine what would be the nutrient threshold for this particular property of vitamin D. And we're speaking about another property that is not the skeletal and calcium metabolism relationship, but this other property of vitamin D. And the threshold value that we would want to reach, again, if there is a specific relationship, remains to be defined. So those are my first comments. It was a very nice presentation, Anna, and I'm sure kind of Camilla and I would be happy, and Anna as well, and Andrea, to try to deal with any of the questions of this very large and enthusiastic audience.
Yes, thank you, John, very much for your comments. Indeed, the extraskeletal effects of vitamin D are a totally open issue, and fantastic interest for endocrinologists and not only. There are a lot of questions, so I would like to, many of them are related to the dose of vitamin D, because this is one of the issues that always puzzle everybody. How much vitamin D should I have to recommend to the general population and to the special population, like for example pregnancy. So we'd like to start with a discussion about doses, because one of the thing that one reads in the literature is that there is an embarrassing variability of the doses that are recommended. And would like to ask what are the doses that should be recommended in general, and possibly if there are consideration, although there are no data in the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay. Anna, would you like to start?
Okay, I think it's important to evaluate the level of 25 of blood examination of 25 hydroxy vitamin D, because maybe in this particular setting we need to reach a level around 40-50 nanograms milliliter, something much more than the level you usually maintain in osteoporotic patient, because the possible effect of vitamin D on immune system is need more supplements. So I generally prefer to avoid bolus administration. And I prefer the weekday
Anna, sorry, I have to ask you to be very short in your answer because your voice is not
okay.
So thank you. Camilla, please.
Yes, well, Anna pointed out that it would be nice if we could always measure the vitamin D concentration, but as we all know, that's not possible. So we should give out some advice to everyone. And of course, we know that older people need larger doses. That would be at least, I would say, 20 micrograms per day. And then, of course, the black population often need more. And then the people who stay a lot at home, don't go out. As we saw the data from different countries, I think that's something that we could take into consideration as well. So actually Portugal had quite low average vitamin D levels. So look into your country data.
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Camilla. This is very important. And so the essay of vitamin D is important. I would like to ask John, because when there is the keyword calcium, I always think to John. So is a question about when to give vitamin D together with calcium, and Natia is asking when you recommend vitamin D with calcium and in which case without calcium.
Thank you, Andrea. There is a misconception about calcium and vitamin D, and a lot of my patients feel that vitamin D will not work unless the administration is with calcium, and that is not true. What you need is vitamin D sufficiency, and that can be established by giving vitamin D, and there is, as we know, many ways of giving vitamin D. The important point is to ensure vitamin D sufficiency. Whether the vitamin D is given with calcium or not, that is not the point. Vitamin D needs to be at the appropriate nutritional level. And for this discussion, you know, let's not get into a semantic about what is the minimal adequate level. We're talking about a safe nutrient, and I always would rather give more vitamin D than less, as long as we, of course, are respectful about not giving a toxic amount. If the amount is adequate, then calcium will be absorbed separately or with vitamin D.
Very good, thank you very much. This is a very important point. Concerning the sun exposure, because obviously there is an interest now that the season is improving, concerning how much a person should expose himself or herself to the sun for getting enough vitamin D. And Zeynep is asking this. Anna, can you answer to this question?
Okay. We have to expose to sunlight.
Because otherwise we don't see you, Anna.
I suggest to stay at sunlight for 10 minutes.
No, we don't hear you. Sorry for this. Camilla, can you tell us something?
10 minutes and for 20, 25
Anna,
minutes.
Sorry, we don't hear you well. I have to switch to Camilla.
Yes, Camilla. Well, I think Anna tried to tell us that we should have sunshine for 10 minutes per day.
Okay.
And
yes.
Then maybe one important thing is that, you know, the skin doctors are very, very concerned about getting melanoma.
Yes.
So we should be careful not to give too strong advice on getting our vitamin D from burning ourselves from the sun.
Yes, I agree with Camilla.
Okay, thank you very much. This is important because if you didn't agree, it would be the same. So John, the idea that Yara is asking do you already see any possible signs or promises from the prophylactic effect of vitamin D on COVID-19 infection and on the clinical presentation? So what is your idea in this respect?
Well, I think that's a very important question as to whether or not patients who have vitamin D in whatever amount we would like to reach would be in any way protected, either with regard to the infection itself, or the severity or the outcome. And Anna reviewed the very little data we have from Italy, other countries we're going to learn about. I don't know. I do not know what the answer to that question is, but I would say, again, to err on the side of safety and precaution, to try to have everyone in the population vitamin D sufficient. And Anna gave an idea of what levels that might be. And at countries where we don't measure vitamin D, some level that's safe, like 2,000 or 3,000 units per day or the equivalent, at least it won't be harmful. And potentially it could be helpful.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, John. There are several questions. Is Katuna, is also Tamar, asking about vitamin D and pregnancy. We know that pregnancy is not that involved in COVID-19 story, fortunately, so far. But Camilla, would you like to comment about this idea of vitamin D in pregnancy? And also Theofanis is asking recommendation for breastfeeding. So many questions, and the questions are flooding. I don't think we will be able to answer to all of them in such a short time. I will ask our organizers to collect all the questions that we will not be able to answer today in these few minutes, write them down, and we will, I promise, we will answer in writing to all of you who didn't see their question asked in the live session. So, Camilla, coming back to you, the idea of vitamin D pregnancy and breastfeeding.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Andrea. That's a very good question, obviously, and we all know that during pregnancy and during breastfeeding, you should take a multivitamin pill, and they usually have enough vitamin D. And you should, of course, if you are breastfeeding for a long time, be very careful that you get enough calcium as well. So that's the short answer. And thank you all for giving us so many questions. That's great.
Yes, yes, but I know my chicken. I knew that there were going to be thousands of questions. The topic is of paramount importance and very stimulating. John, Anna mentioned something about obesity, and Manel, our friend Manel, is asking doses of vitamin D in obese and morbidly obese obese people. Can you comment on this?
Yes, thank you, Andrea. Just one comment about the question about pregnancy.
Yes.
In the last trimester of pregnancy, the placenta becomes a source of active vitamin D. So it's a very interesting mechanism by which the fetus obtains more calcium at that later stage of pregnancy. But of course, I agree with Camilla that vitamin D should be appropriately supplemented. In terms of obesity, this is a paradox. Patients who are obese, if you look at their total body vitamin D stores, and that is through the 25-hydroxyvitamin D, which does get stored in fat, actually obese people have a lot of vitamin D. The problem is that it is in the fat cells, and it doesn't get into the circulation or to target tissues, and thus it is, if you will, sequestered and not available. So the typical obese person, even though total body vitamin D stores may be adequate, the circulating levels are low. And that is a very important point because that defines the vitamin D deficiency. So it's a problem, and the obesity, and as it is a risk factor for COVID-19, as I've just said, it's very, very important that obese subjects get enough vitamin D, not only to saturate their fat depots, but also to have enough in their circulation.
Thank you, John, very much. There are two comments that I would like to convey to you that are interesting. And one is Roberta's from Lithuania, saying that in Lithuania, vitamin D deficiency is also very significant, as in Italy, but the incidence and mortality of COVID-19 are significantly lower than in Italy. So he asked how much can be important vitamin D deficiency per se, or what are the possible contributing aspect to this. And the other question from Niar is that the incidence of vitamin D in India is huge, 90% of the people. So he's asking, what is the figure in Europe? And in fact, he say, in India, if we assay vitamin D to the people that are hospitalized for COVID, they will be low, because 90% of the population do have low vitamin D. So I would like to understand if Anna now can speak. So I found finally a way not making Anna speaking. So connecting her with the computer. This is great.
No, I heard you. So obviously we need
the you. We don't hear you. Obviously, this is the problem. Okay, go ahead.
We need a study about these hypotheses of relation between vitamin D and COVID-19. We need randomized control trials, and this is an hypothesis. We cannot say is the only thing that counts in infection, in this kind of infection. And for what concerns the prevalence of hypovitaminosis D, also in our elderly people in Italy, the percentage is around 80%, 86%, similar to India.
Okay, thank you very much, Anna. We were able to understand something that you said, not everything, but it's okay. John, I have a question for you. Helen is asking about hypoparathyroidism. So this is obviously having yourself is here in the panel is an obvious question. So hypoparathyroidism is strictly related to vitamin D, to calcium. So what to do in hypopara patient? What to do in the emergency of hypocalcemia in hypopara patient? And Ellen is asking these two questions. And there was also another question on hypoparathyroidism, and there was similar to this. So John, can you say something about hypoparathyroidism?
Yeah, I could say something about hypoparathyroidism.
Much more than something, I would
yeah,
say.
I know.
I will
refer those of you who are interested in hypoparathyroidism. I just wrote a mini review in Journal of Clinical Endocrinology and Metabolism that was just published, and you will find a fair amount of information there. But with specific regard to the question of a hypocalcemic emergency, the treatment actually is not vitamin D. The treatment is intravenous calcium. That is really the only way you can deal quickly with the symptoms of hypocalcemia. It is true in hypoparathyroidism that patients are often vitamin D deficient. That's for three reasons. Without parathyroid hormone, the alpha hydroxylase in the kidney is not active. The high phosphate inhibits, and the enzyme itself may be inactive. So vitamin D is a very important element in the management of hypoparathyroidism for sure, both active vitamin D and parent vitamin D. But for the acute management, it has to be intravenous calcium.
Thank you very much, John. Also, Leeds, here is written Elizabeth, but I know him via Twitter, and I know that I can call her Leeds. I would like to add that we recently described the case of severe hypocalcemia in a patient with unknown hypoparathyroidism, but with previous total thyroidectomy. And this has been published in Endocrine a couple of weeks ago. And this was interesting because apparently COVID-19 was a sort of a situation in which COVID really was able to disclose a sort of a latent or a partial hypoparathyroidism. So I think that this topic merits some further evaluation, and the idea that hypocalcemia is also frequent in other, as you know, in other pandemic like SARS or like MERS or like also Ebola. So I think that this question, I like very much, Liz and Ellen, this question about hypoparathyroidism. Let's work together. I know that you represent also the patients with hypoparathyroidism, and would like to see a combined effort in this respect, because there is probably a lot to know in this particular situation. So we have, I would say, 5 minutes more for questions. I'm really embarrassed because we should have had at least half an hour more to ask all the questions, and I knew that we were opening something like a Pandora, something that was impossible to finish so quickly. Another question is related to the giving vitamin D in which way? Parenteral way, oral way, and this is something that other people is asking. So parenteral way, oral way, daily, weekly, monthly administration, and these are not just related to COVID situation. These are related to, in general, to supplementation in vitamin D. So Camilla, would you like to comment on these practical questions, way of administration, time of administration?
Yes, thank you, Andrea. That's a good question. If the vitamin D levels are really low and we would like to increase them quickly, we should give a parenteral bolus and then start at the same time, I think, by giving it orally as well. So that's the short answer.
And then, yes, of course, thank you very much for being, you know, you understood that we need, we really need to be quick, and it is clear that for every question that you would like to ask afterwards, we are really available, and you know, even to go in detail, but now to involve more the most people possible, because obviously I would like to put value on the fact that so many people were connected today and would like to ask the most possible question. And another thing is related to the type of vitamin D, because now we talked about way of administration, timing of administration. Now Laura is asking, something concerning the type of vitamin D, because in COVID-19, she's a little bit skeptical, I would like to say, about the fact that vitamin D can be a treatment for COVID. But this is not the message that Anna was trying to convey. We really think that it's important that vitamin D is correctly substituted to put the people in the right position to respond to the infection. This is the main message, at least with the data we have so far. On Twitter, somebody said that trying to combat COVID with vitamin D was like using the sling against a nuclear weapon. And I told that with a slingshot, David killed Goliath. So please remember that not because vitamin D is cheap, vitamin D is something that we know very well, this is not important. So this was the message. So, and I comment on a type of vitamin D that you would like to use, and the idea that COVID-19 may impair hepatic metabolism of vitamin D, and therefore maybe other forms than cholecalciferol may be used.
No, I said I always suggest to try to start with cholecalciferol. We also can evaluate calcifediol for starting if you want to make a rapid increase in 25-hydroxy vitamin D levels, but cholecalciferol is the best choice for general population, also okay. In COVID.
Thank you very much. Another question is from Satish. Camilla, you know, I'm not inventing the question. Really, you know, they far go beyond my imagination. So this is, you know, this is not the situation in which I'm trying to make, you know, apparent that there is an involvement and are all my questions. These are all questions from our attendants. So Camilla, a question about a correlation between vitamin D3 and hypothyroidism. So thyroid now, because obviously the people are not satisfied just to talk about vitamin D. Now vitamin D and the thyroid. Do you have something to add on this?
If someone else has, then I'm happy to give over the microphone to someone else.
Thank you, Camilla. John, a comment on vitamin D and thyroid?
Well, we're not going to be able to answer that question very well. The only connection I could see would be in severe hypothyroidism, there might be malabsorption. We do know there's malabsorption. And so such individuals can be vitamin D deficient. There is kind of an obesity of hypothyroidism, not real obesity, but a distribution of fat. But in general, I don't recognize, except in severe hypothyroidism, a relationship between vitamin D and thyroid disease. Maybe somebody else does.
Okay. But we could consider that in hypovitaminosis D may be linked to autoimmune pathologies, as for example Hashimoto's thyroiditis.
I don't think we have any evidence for that. Sorry.
Yes, it's very tiny the evidence. Even if my friend Leonidas is a huge supporter of this theory, but I agree that there are data that are not totally concordant on this. There is another question by Nickel. Do any of the countries with long lockdown do have recommended vitamin D for the general public? Mikkel, I would like to ask to answer to this question, saying that Anna was correct when she was saying that when our letter on the BMJ appeared, there was, I would say, a little, to use an understatement, a little of skepticism about this. But now the evidence has mounted, and I would like to say that both in the UK, you have seen in last slide of Anna the editorial of Fiona Mitchell in the Lancet Diabetes Endocrinology, but also in Italy, there has been some attention from the Istituto Superiore di Sanità, the Superior Health Institute, about this topic. As usual, what happens is that when it really is needed, the people don't know, and so are not, let's say, interested. Now that probably is not much needed, the people start to maybe understanding that this can be important. But, you know, let's think that it could be a lesson for the next, hopefully, very, very in the very far future, next pandemic that we will have to face. So I think this is the best answer that I can give you. And the last question, I take Blerta question, and then I have, really, I'm sorry, but it's 5 to 5, and I have been warned to close not late than 5 o'clock. So the idea of Berta is saying type 1 diabetes, because Anna mentioned diabetes in general. So the idea that diabetes can be associated, but we generally speak about type 2 diabetes when we speak about diabetes, and also when we speak about COVID, fortunately. So she asked, what about the correlation between the possibility of having, seems type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disease, association between vitamin D deficiency and type 1 diabetes? Anna, do you have something to comment?
Yes, I would like to say that here in our population, we have a few persons with diabetes 1 and COVID-19, but obviously also vitamin D is absolutely to test in people with diabetes 1, because also in these people, even if less frequently than in type 2, we could have hypovitaminosis D.
Thank you very much, Anna. I'm really sorry for all the questions that I was not able to ask to our panel, but really were too many, guys. This suggests me that we can have another seminar on vitamin D sooner or later, not without Anna, I promise, but because, you know, it was impossible to hear at the webinar, but with another speaker, maybe chosen among the two prestigious panelists that we had today. So this allows me to have a real word of appreciation for their time and for their presence, for their capacity to animate this webinar. Thank you very much, Camilla, for being with us. Look forward to see you very soon. Thank you very much, John. You were amazing as usual, and it was really a pleasure to host you here at the European Society of Endocrinology Talks. And maybe the next talk will invite you to speak about vitamin D. And obviously, last but not least, I was joking before, Anna, you did a wonderful job. I'm proud of you. Thank you very much. A lot of people congratulating with you, saying that you were fantastic. Obviously, they are very kind, and we appreciate their kindness. But obviously, a big appreciation to you also from myself. Last thing to say, apart of thanking everybody that was able to join and to stay with us until the last minute, I tried to answer all your questions, and I hope that the answers were satisfying you, but please come back if there are other doubts or things that you would like to clarify. We came out also with nice ideas on hypoparathyroidism with LEADS and all the hypopara group. So I am very happy about that and proud of all the people that watched. Remember that next week there will be the next Easy Talks about Cushing, and we will have another speaker of great prestige, John Newell Price, one of the world experts in the disease, speaking about Cushing in the era of COVID-19. And for the first time, I will not be with you. So please follow the webinar, even if I will not be present. Thank you very much to all. See you very soon. Ciao. Ciao.